Gun violence has again rocked the US. At least 5 people have been killed and 18 others injured in a shooting at a gay nightclub in Colorado Springs. Just before midnight local time, patrons heard gunshots on the dance floor. 2 heroic people confronted the attacker and stopped him from continuing to fire. A 22-year-old suspect is in custody and being treated for injuries. Police are labelling it a hate crime attack.
The suspect has been identified as Anderson Lee Aldrich, a 22-year-old male. At least 2 firearms were found at the scene. We are still working to identify the firearms and who they belong to, but I can confirm that the suspect used a long rifle during the shooting.
The FBI is assisting local police with investigations. The shooting is the 6th mass killing this month in the US. The World Cup has officially kicked off in Qatar with a spectacular opening ceremony and star performance. Acting legend Morgan Freeman took centre stage, playing a starring role before the first match. His appearance wasn't the only surprise after a beer ban was imposed. It's the latest controversial snag for the event under scrutiny for Qatar's human rights record. Accompanied by a long list of celebrities, Morgan promoted unity and respect for the tournament.
This is all so new. All that I have known before was a land that seemed to be in turmoil, with families who were forgotten, and I stopped hearing your voice.
Come on over.
Ecuador made history, scoring the opening goal over host Qatar and easing past the Maroons, winning 2-0. Fans celebrating near and far described the match as their dream team start. Fare-free train travel is now in full effect for Sydney commuters. It kicked off at midnight and will run through the week until Friday night. Opal card readers are turned off for Sydney trains, metro services and the airport link and the inner city link. Bus lines, ferries and light rail trips, however, will not be free. It's all because the New South Wales Premier agreed to a union demand for free fares, avoiding strikes that would have crippled the network. Tasmania is set to get lashed by an icy polar blast today, with snow forecast to blanket regions above 500 metres in Hobart and the Derwent Valley. Residents are being warned to brace for wild winds and a possible hailstorm. Hobart's maximum temperature today will be just 13 degrees, with chilly conditions persisting until Wednesday. Strong gusts above 90 kilometres an hour are also expected to batter Sydney down to the south coast today. There are currently 101 flood warnings in place across New South Wales, with the small town of Deniliquin in the Riverina the latest to be told to evacuate. The floodwaters in the central west are flowing from Forbes and hitting downstream communities along the Lachlan River. In Condobolin, residents are using a wall of sandbags to protect their town. They're bracing for river levels to peak on Wednesday, which could see it pass the 1894 record. Outlying communities have already been stranded for weeks. Politicians are back in Canberra this morning, gearing up for a very busy 2 weeks. 10 News First, Chloe Boris joins us live now from Parliament House. And Chloe, what's on the agenda?
Good morning. There is a fair bit, actually. Today marks 6 months since the election, so the Labor government is very keen to pass legislation before the end of the year, and now's the time to do that. The most controversial is an industrial relations bill, which will be debated in the Senate. Labor says it's designed to get wages moving, but critics are campaigning hard against this, saying it'll cost jobs and hurt small and medium-sized businesses by giving the unions more power. Labor really needs crossbench support on that one. There are also bills around establishing a national anti-corruption commission and also for cheaper childcare. Those 2 were election promises, and it's now looking very likely that extra sitting days will be put on to get through it all.
Thanks for that, Chloe. A historic deal has been struck at the COP27 summit in Egypt that will see wealthy nations compensate poorer ones for the fallout from climate change. The agreement made between almost 200 countries will establish a loss and damage fund. It's unclear exactly what will trigger a payout from the fund and where the money will come from. The final overarching deal did not include commitments to phase down or reduce the use of fossil fuels.
We recognise that there have been indications of a disappointment in certain quarters who had a higher degree of ambition. But that disappointment, I think, should be put in context. I think the level of ambition of all of the parties is equal.
Critics warn the deal has fallen short to prevent a 1.5 degrees Celsius warming of the Earth. Cyber criminals have escalated their attack against Medibank, releasing the sensitive personal information of about 1,500 Australians on the dark web. Medibank is still refusing to budge on the $15.5 million ransom demand.
Russian cyber criminals upping the ante in their war against Medibank.
These people are complete grubs, pure and simple.
After laying dormant for days, they released the fifth batch of sensitive patient information. Four folders of nearly 1,500 records published on the dark web, labelled sexually transmitted diseases, HIV, psycho and viral hep.
It is well beyond the pale to see this kind of private, sensitive information released into the public domain.
The private health insurer is standing firm, refusing to pay the $15 million ransom.
Maybe they're in the misguided belief that if they keep doing this, a ransom will come along their way.
Medibank confirming it's bolstering its customer support team by more than 300 people and urging customers to remain vigilant during this distressing breach.
All they can really do is look out for phishing attacks and monitor their bank account details.
Following the Medibank and Optus data breaches, a joint standing operation was launched to investigate and disrupt cyber criminal syndicates.
The government is prepared to do its bit. I'm confident the private sector is prepared to do its bit as well.
Stella Todorovic for 10 News First.
A proposed overhaul of WA's tough abortion laws could see barriers relaxed, removing the need for some women to travel interstate to end a pregnancy. The changes could include increasing the gestational limit for abortion from 20 weeks to 24, removing the need for GP referrals and scrapping mandatory counselling.
But we believe that in the 21st century it is time to take away the rules and judgments around abortion and leave the decision-making with the woman and her medical practitioner.
Women and healthcare providers have been invited to have their say before a conscience vote is held in Parliament.